our special guest and speaker today is Michael Magic Cozy. During the 80s, he traveled the United States and spent time in Los Angeles as an illusionist and hypnotist entertainer. So he has been hypnotized all the time. That's the deal we have. That's not his career now, but while he did that in the 80s, he has become a safety trainer, instructor, manager for the trucking industry. He's a public speaker, safety instructor for federal motor carrier safety regulations. He's also been, of course, a magician and hypnotist. He's the owner of Video Birmingham and does videography and video producing and directing, as well as project manager on a wide variety of video applications. So we're glad to have him here today, and I'm not going to tell his story about how he came to have faith in God and discovered him, but I'm going to allow him to do that for us as he comes. So give him a warm Hilldale welcome. Michael Cozy, a.k.a. Magic.
Until we met, that we were content with the single life. It sounds a little grant when we both had given up finding a life partner. Anyhow, we got married in 2010. We bought a house. We brought home a 10-pound furry baby from Maltese named Riley Sarah Wigglebottom. And she rules us with an iron paw. Now, as an aside, a recent study that if they did a recent study found that, that for the men out there, your dog actually loves you more than your wife. And to prove this, they said, go home, put your wife and your dog in the trunk of your car, come back an hour later and see who's happy to see you. I had lost, going back about 3 years, I'd lost about 75 pounds, was running 3 miles a day. I was in the best shape of my life. I'd been going to the gym for the last 40 years, but I finally got it to work. January 3rd, 2014, I'd run 3 miles that day. I get ready to go to bed. Dana was already asleep. And I got this tremendous pain on my side, all up and down my side. We thought, I didn't wake her up, we thought that I was having a heart attack, which was turned out not to be the case. She drove me to the emergency room. We live in Alabaster. She drove me to the emergency room shelter. I walked in, and that was the last time I walked in. We got in there, and it turned out after several hours, they came back and said that I was in complete kidney failure. Well, if that was all that was wrong with me, we could have dealt with that. They came back a few hours later and said that I had AML leukemia. Now, that's strange because I had been to my regular doctor 3 weeks prior just for my checkup, and everything was fine. They don't know what causes it. They don't know. It's a cancer of the blood, to put it in its simplest terms. That was the beginning of our journey. I had so many drugs in me at one point, I was completely unconscious for days on end. At one point, this was about, I think, 3 days into being checked into the hospital. I had been out for 3 days. Dana told me later that she was sitting in the room singing hymns to me and singing Christmas songs. That's one of the things that I've told her, that when my time finally does get here, I don't care if it's in the middle of July, I want Christmas Eve. Dana was at the end. Well, she had hit a brick wall. She had nothing left. She told me that she prayed and asked God for something. Sign, a mustard seed, something to hang on to. God answered the prayer. Just 10 minutes later, I woke up. Not only did I wake up, I was completely lucid. I was as though nothing had happened. Dana told me later that that's what she hung on for the next 6 months. I told her in that span of 45 minutes of a don't know what to call this, vision, an answered prayer, a dream, don't know. But I found myself during that, somewhere during the time that I was out, found myself in a room, in a white room, with two pools of water. The water was white. The room was white, the floor was white, the walls, everything. I don't know how I differentiated between the two, but I did. One body of water was choppy, tumultuous, violent, and the other was calm and serene. I was given a choice. I didn't so much as hear a voice, but I knew, and I don't know how else to explain it. I was given a choice to either take the path of serene tranquility, and everything would be great, or I could go down the tumultuous side, and it would be a rough go of things. I saw Riley Sarah Wigglebottom's tail on the tumultuous side, and that's the path that I took. We believe at that juncture that God gave us a choice. I say us, meaning my bride and me, because through this whole journey, as sick as I got, she had it rough. Not only was she by my side for the entire 6 months and 6 days, she had to run the household as well. And she did that. And we had unbelievable answered prayers along the way. I ended up spending over the next 6 months in 5 different hospitals. I was transferred out of Shelby to UAB. UAB was better equipped to handle what I had. I got to UAB, they took me in an ambulance and took me up there. This was about the time, I'm sure you recall, the great blizzard that came through 3 years ago. I don't remember it, if you guys remember it. Dan Up was going to follow the ambulance from Shelby County to UAB. My bride doesn't go downtown. My bride gets lost. She is directionally challenged. I kid you not, she called me once from a business trip. She was in Miami, inside Walmart. She was lost inside Walmart. But I can't find my way out of the store. And I tell you that to make it all come home. She had to stop to get fuel as the ambulance took me on down. This was about 2 o'clock in the morning. So she gets downtown and has no idea, can't find a place to park. And she is beside herself. She pulls into a closed McDonald's down there. And she breaks down. She's crying and she cries out to God and she says, I need a place to park. I got to get into the hospital. And she looked up and there was a sign flashing for a parking garage. She says, that was the day that God moved the building for her. Got into the hospital. Over the course of the time. One of the things that they do to try to attack the evil is they have to kill you. And that they destroy your immune system so that you are susceptible to every bacteria or disease. At this juncture, I had gotten sepsis, I got MRSA, I got things that the antibiotics don't fix. My blood pressure at this point had dropped so low, it was just a matter of time before I went home. giving back. The doctors had pretty much set up housekeeping in my room. At one point, they had given me like 5 different medications to try to raise my blood pressure. I just wasn't registered. In the process of all that, they had also given me some sort of steroid that set my blood sugar through the roof to the point that the meters wouldn't read it. That's when my retina patch kind of went blind. And it gets better. Doctors on 2 different occasions during this blizzard, because nobody else could get to the hospital, so Dan had no one to lean on. The doctors told her on 2 separate occasions he's not going to make it through the night. And her response was, you never know what God's going to do. Well, I came back to sort of tighten this up just a little bit. We spent, I think, the next 3 months at UAB going between their bone marrow ward and their ICU and different parts of the hospital. In the process, I developed sacroiliac, which is the lower back. It ate away and pretty much put a hole in my back. But I still had to make it. That came from just being comatose for that length of time. The fix for that, if you will, was to put a sponge bandage over it and hook a vacuum cleaner up to it. That's pretty close to accurate. It's a vacuum system that sucks on it constantly. We named the device Rosemary, because it was constant and it was painful. It was a gaping open wound. When they had done everything that they could do for me at UAB, I was transferred over to Select. At this point, I was about as close to being quadriplegic as you could get. Nothing in me worked. My hands were balled up like this, up against my chest. Nothing worked. I will tell you, if you have never been in a hospital on an extended stay, one of the things they make you do is you check your dignity at the front door, because you have none of your mire in there. So imagine everything you do at home in private now becomes a spectator sport. Everything. I had at one time, I think, 11 tubes going into me, plus ports. I was on so much medication just trying to keep me alive. I had some wicked dreams. I was a secret agent in China. I was a chancellor in Mobile. I don't even know what a chancellor is. And if you, at the time, had hooked me up to a lie detector, I would probably pass. That's how real these things were. We had, once they got medically all they could do for me, I had to go either to a nursing home or to a rehab hospital. The only rehab hospital that would allow my bride to stay with me was Lakeshore. The nursing homes would not allow anybody to stay with me. Now understand, I was completely dependent for everything. I couldn't feed myself. Lakeshore had a policy in writing. They wouldn't take anybody that had no work. Mine was a stage four, which is as bad as it gets. Lakeshore in writing says, no, we can't take anybody with an open wound. It's against our policy. We prayed about it. Guess where I spent the next 3 months? It was in Lakeshore. God answered so many prayers for us. We could not keep up with it. When we don't believe in coincidence, when you ask for something and God delivers it immediately, how do you not believe that he's in control of everything? Not done yet. I spent 6 weeks, 12 weeks in Lakeshore. 9 weeks in Lakeshore. The reason that's important is because nobody stays more than 3 weeks. Insurance won't pay for it. They can't do what they're supposed to do over that 3 week period. You get shipped out. We stayed 9 weeks. Insurance never better than 9 months. Paid for everything. I tell you this because none of this is normal. This should not happen. I should be pushing up daisies at this point. We get to Lakeshore. They strap me on a, I used to call it the Frankenstein table, and try and get me elevated to the table, and strap me down and try to lift you up. They couldn't lift me straight up, my blood pressure would drop. I think they finally gave up, and after 9 weeks, I went home. I went home, and the insurance company had bought me a $20,000 convertible. It was a power wheelchair. I could barely operate a little control. They also sent home what's called a Hoyer lift, which is a device they use to lift you in and out of bed. They had me in a sling, and my bride would come down every morning, hook me up to the sling, crank me up, and set me down in the wheelchair. And in all that time, she only dropped me once. When I came home, my hands were bundled up like this, up against my chest. I had to be fed. I would slide down in this chair, and they would, someone would have to come and pull me back up. I couldn't get up. I couldn't do anything. Insurance paid for therapy. We had a fellow showed up quite by accident, actually, if you believe in those kind of accidents. His name was Steve Howe. He's physical therapist. I can't even call him my physical therapist. He's got a smile on his face when he's bending and stretching things that shouldn't be bent or stretched. He decided one day that we were going to stand up. And I said, well, I'm not trying to. He put a belt around me. At this point, I had dropped down to, I probably lost a total of 150 pounds. belt around me, lifted me up, and all I could do was hang there. My chest, my head was in his chest, and that's all I could do. And he wouldn't give up. He would not give up. He stayed and came 3 days a week to our house. The longest patient that he had ever had prior to us, again, due to insurance issues, was 6 weeks. He stayed with us for a year and a half. Tell me that God wasn't in control. I reached most of the goals that we had set. The only one that I did not reach at the time we were doing it was, we lived in, I said we lived in a split level house. I wanted to climb one step. With somebody holding on, I couldn't lift my foot off the ground. That took an extra 2 months. So from the time I got home, which was in June 2014, until February 2015, took me that long to climb one step. And we did. We had plans before this started. We literally had gone shopping for a new car, and we were looking at getting 2014 Candy Apple Red convertible Mustang. We had plans. I said at the beginning, if you want to make God laugh, as of right now, I rarely use my wheelchair. Not my stuff happened, but I rarely use it. I walk far, but as you know, I have gotten back on the treadmill. I have a recumbent bike that Santa Claus brought me, and I'm doing that. And I have a, elliptical machine. I can get about a minute out of that. But I can't do much more than a minute before I got sick. Folks, what I'm trying to tell you is that God answered our prayers because we needed them at that time. You know, God answers prayers at this time. I'm here to tell you that He answers prayers and He's with us. I am only able to touch on the highlights of everything that we went through. I was part of a men's group for about 15 years at my church. These folks all stepped up and came and gave down 1 day a week to go home. And they stayed with me. These were my extended family, as we folks are. That is the meaning. We are told to love them. You don't know what journey they have gone through. There was a grandfather and his grandson were walking along the beach. And the beach was strewn with starfish, thousands of them. And every now and again, grandpa would reach out to one of the starfish and he would throw it back. It had washed the shore with the tide. After a while, the grandson said, "Pop, why are you doing that?" He said, "Well, if I don't put this starfish back in the water, it's going to die." The grandson looked and he said, "But there's thousands. It won't make any difference." And Grandpa picked up one more and he said, "It makes all the difference in the world with this one." You know don't know what somebody's going through. I promise you they've probably had issues and things going on in the shop. Sit down and think for a while. We're the neighbors. Guys, I told you I would leave you with a little bit of a laugh. You ready for that one?
Yes.
Anybody want to laugh? I need an assistant. Who wants to see some magic? Okay. Who wants to see some magic? I have never done this sitting down. Here. I know what it was. We got to cut the ends off. There we go.